Have you ever wondered why sites like Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter are banned in China? Dubbed the Great Firewall, Chinese censorship would probably block over 90% of your internet usage. If you want to pick up a new book on Amazon, you can't. If you want to catch up on Stranger Things on Netflix, you can't. And the same thing goes for Hulu and Prime Video and basically everything else you use as well. That is, of course, if you don't take advantage of a VPN. While China has made several moves to discourage the use of VPNs, they have not banned the use of VPNs, because this would affect the several international companies in China that rely on VPNs for safe and secure connections. But despite its legality, it's mostly only tourists that use VPNs, and the majority of mainland Chinese population doesn't really care to use a VPN. But it's actually not as bad as you may be imagining, as about a quarter of the global internet users are located in mainland China. They actually use all of the same services that we use on a daily basis, just Chinese alternatives to them. For YouTube, they have Youku, Facebook, they have QQ, WhatsApp, they have WeChat. While these names are by no means familiar in the Western world, these offerings dominate in their home country. But why make all of these substitutes when they accomplish nothing more than their American counterparts? Well, there is one similarity between all of these companies, which is that they are government controlled or follow government set requirements. It is not that Western companies themselves are banned, it's just that usually Western companies refuse to abide by the rules set by the Chinese government. In fact, many American websites are accessible in China like Bing, Hotmail, Yahoo Mail, and streaming giant HBO, who have all agreed to give the Chinese government control of their Chinese segments. But why does the Chinese government even go through all of this trouble? Well, the straightforward answer is to limit free speech and prevent destabilization of the government. By regulating the internet space, China is able to maintain order across the country. Free speech perpetrators can easily be identified and prosecuted, or in some cases, persecuted accordingly, as Chinese internet users are required to provide proof of identity when posting messages on any of the more than 100,000 registered websites used in China. So, one wrong post and you could be seeing the police at your door. But is there more to this than just censorship? Well, here is a dark theory on why China bans American websites that could arguably be true. This theory states that the ban was established to boost the Chinese economy, to rival and eventually surpass the US economy, which would consequently result in an economic cold war between the US and China. This is arguably actually already underway and just hasn't brewed into full-fledged conflict. China has been banning American companies for decades, and recently America has significantly increased its tariffs and even banned Chinese technology giant Huawei. So there's clearly been some sort of on and off rivalry between the two countries for quite some time now. In such a cold war, in our technology driven world, the greatest asset would be data and information about people. Companies like Google, Facebook, and Amazon are experts in this arena, having collected more data about you than you know about yourself. Evidently, China wouldn't want these companies to come into China and also collect data on Chinese citizens as well. This is partially why they have banned such services within the borders, giving rise to Chinese counterparts which are required to report all data to the Chinese government. Today, China is actually in a better position than Google in collecting data. In the West, collecting data is often limited by privacy concerns and human rights activists. But in China, there are no such barriers to collect data. If you aren't quite sold that China would go through all this trouble just for data, think about Google Maps. Is there really a need to block Google Maps in China? Everyone would agree that Google Maps is the best of them all. And how could Google Maps destabilize the Chinese government? There is no anti-Chinese news. In fact, there's no news or opinions on Google Maps at all. Of course, aside from reviews on crappy restaurants, but Google Maps clearly wouldn't be a threat to the Chinese government. The reason China bans Google Maps is because of data. The Chinese government doesn't want Google to mine geographic data from Chinese soil. Instead, in China, people use local maps from companies like Baidu. But why collect all of this data though? What could it even be used for, and how would it benefit either country in an economic cold war? Well, data and information drives innovation in the technological world. For instance, Apple spent millions of dollars developing Face ID, probably starting with dummies and then moving on to people. The Chinese government, on the other hand, could simply filter out the best quality profile pictures from WeChat and use them for face recognition technological development. This would clearly not only be much cheaper, but faster as well. On top of this, by controlling the internet, the Chinese government is able to quickly get the public to adopt any new technology. If the government were to come across a new AI application that is clearly effective in improving living convenience of citizens while maintaining social stability and safety, they can rapidly roll out this new technology across all 300 cities in a matter of days. No Western country would be able to accomplish an adoption of new technology nearly as quickly. And of course, something that we can't avoid discussing is Chinese protectionism, which may be the most important reason. From China's perspective, it would be much better economically to block international competitors and allow for domestic giants to rise. Tech giants dominate the Fortune 500 list, from Google to Amazon to Facebook. They are each worth hundreds of billions of dollars, and if they were allowed in China, which has about a quarter of all internet users worldwide, these companies would easily cross the $1 trillion mark. Now, why would China allow for these American companies to grow even bigger than they already are? And this could be the simple reason why they blocked out Western competitors in order to foster domestic growth of knockoff companies. Just take a look at China's biggest tech companies like Tencent, Xiaomi, and Huawei. These companies offer products and services that are strikingly similar to American counterparts and enter the market after American companies. Today, Tencent is worth $443 billion and Xiaomi is worth $217 billion. And this is just two of the biggest tech companies, and there are several other companies just like this. These companies significantly boost the Chinese GDP and economy, and aside from exports, are no doubt the biggest contributors to Chinese growth and development. So, without Chinese government banning Western companies, they wouldn't have even grown to a position to rival the US economy. In essence, this ban has not only enabled China to battle the US economically, but has also given them an upper hand in terms of data access and technological adoption. So what would take place if an economic cold war unfolds between the two economic giants of the world? Well, what started as a trade war would escalate into a permanent state of mutual animosity. Traces of this can already be seen in Trump administration's national security strategy, which categorizes China as a strategic competitor that should be contained on all fronts. The US would increase restrictions on Chinese foreign direct investment in sensitive sectors, and industries such as artificial intelligence and 5G would be heavily contained within the US to ensure Western dominance. But there would be one major obstacle, which is that the US and Chinese economies are heavily intertwined. If we take a look back at the US and the Soviet Union, they traded very little with each other, while China is fully integrated in the global trading and investment system. Not only is America very dependent on Chinese manufacturing, but China has grown accustomed to American products like the iPhone. In fact, the Chinese market is actually Apple's biggest market for iPhones, not America. As a result, an economic cold war would usher in an era of deglobalization in which interdependence and integration of units around the world would be stifled. Or at least, two incompatible economic blocs would form, obviously one based in China and the other based in America. But who would be on each side? Well, in such a balkanized world, China and America would expect all countries to pick a side. But most countries will try to perform an impossible balancing act of maintaining good economic relationships with both countries. After all, most of US allies do more trading with China than they do with America. But in this future where the US and China would separately control access to essential future technologies like AI and 5G, the middle ground will become uninhabitable and everyone will have to choose one side or the other. While this conflict would have economic origins, at this point, this would no doubt transition into political face-off between democratic countries and communist countries. Now, hopefully, we will take a look at history and avoid warfare and keep things as peaceful as possible, because a war at this point would lead to nothing but destruction and really no winners. On top of a technological race, including things like autonomous vehicles and machine learning, we may see another space race, this time between China and the US, on who can reach Mars first. But in the end, if something similar to the original Cold War unravels here, we would see an eventual overthrow of the Great Chinese Firewall, which may become iconic of this war, just like the Berlin Wall. Following this, we would see the entrance of Western competitors like Google, YouTube, and Facebook entering the Chinese-controlled markets. And then we would see the fall of Chinese giants, not because they are necessarily bad services or because they themselves did anything wrong, but because of the ideologies they represent and the principles that they are related to. This would lead to a vast range of different possibilities, maybe even a world with no borders, which is both cherished and despised by just as many people. And we may finally see the fall of oppressive regimes like North Korea and Vietnam. Not delving too much into politics and taking a look back on the economic side, we would witness a process of re-globalization which would be accelerated by common technological goals. After the Cold War, the International Space Station really united the world into accomplishing one common goal. In our timeline, this could be colonizing Mars or implementing autonomous vehicles into day-to-day life. Taking a look back, what started as a ban meant to boost the domestic Chinese economy and collect information while ensuring stability of the Chinese government has led to strong tensions between the US and China. These tensions can easily evolve into another Cold War, which would likely end in the fall of the Great Firewall. So, what was established to protect the Chinese government may come back and take it down. But this is just the dark theory of the Great Chinese Firewall, and we may very well not witness this timeline unfold at all. Meanwhile, you can thank the Chinese government for making your internet experience pleasant, as websites would no doubt be bogged down if suddenly another 800 million people started using them. But as history has shown us, most oppressive things will one day fall. And we may very well have to deal with the day where Google starts lagging because of all the new users. But what do you guys think will happen to the Great Chinese Firewall? Make sure to comment that down below. Also, if you guys liked this video, then make sure to drop a like and consider subscribing if you would like to see more videos just like this one. But until then, I'm Hari, and I'll see you guys on the next one.